sun. It is life, but don't be for sale. And don't be the like it, and all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Great things. Jesus the Son, but purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect, oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood to every believer, the promise of God, the vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. And give him the glory, great things he hath done.
The song about to sing just talks about trusting God and actually following him, and pray to recognize that we need God every single day. It's easy when we are in tough spots and we're crying out to God like, I need help. But sometimes when things are going well, and even as we were talking about in youth this morning about school year coming up, do we always actually go to God when we have new, like, chapters in our lives where things are changing, or we have decisions to make, or just even how we approach like work every day or our home? Do we actually go to God and ask him to lead us and guide us, and then we follow him and choose to trust him no matter what happens? So just as we sing that this morning, I pray that that'll be our heart's cry to God.
Oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your grace. For I have. You are my.
I pray that no matter where you call us in our lives, Lord, would you lead us, or Lord, where we are, I pray that we will say yes to you, God, and that we will ask you to lead. I think there's so many times we don't ask you to lead, Lord. We might make decisions, or we might make choices, even in the moment, that they're not really guided by you. And I pray that we would ask you, as hard as it could be sometimes, with an open heart, to say, God, lead me, guide me. And sometimes that means that we have to change direction. And I pray that though wherever you call us, God, that we will, Lord, we will follow you no matter what. I pray that we remember, Lord, that you live in us. And I pray that we would lay our lives before you and leave our old ways behind, knowing that you call us to something better. Christ lives in us, and we worship him along with all creation. And so let us do that this morning. And we sing, Lord Most High. God, I pray that you be magnified above everything, that your name would be lifted high. And not that we just worship you, God, and say you are bigger than anything that we can see or experience and that you have made everything. But God, our response would be to just lay our lives at your feet, God, that wherever you call us, we would go. And we'd toss our life, like that song said, like ashes to the waves, because you come first, God. And I pray that you would come and lead us and guide us and that we'd respond to you this morning. Thank you for giving us such a great gift. A forgiveness of our sins through Jesus, and let that be the center of our worship this morning, and what you did for us. We ask in your precious name. Amen.
If you'll take your Bibles and turn with me to Luke, the 23rd chapter. Although we're actually going to start reading a little bit elsewhere, but it's real close to that. So go to Luke 23 and make sure you put something in there so you don't lose it. Today we're going to, in a sense, we've been going this way already, but we're going to get to the place in Scripture. Today I've given the message title, At Calvary, and we're going to look now and next time of the final hours of Jesus' life on earth before his crucifixion and then follow right into everything that happens after that. And really we are on holy ground when we do that. And I just want to say today we're going to talk about how Jesus Christ was delivered up to die for our sins. I hope you know that, but that's what we're going to talk about. And that word delivered comes all over the place in this message. He was delivered up for us. And we want to think about that today as we look at Calvary. We're going to be looking at chapter 23, and we're going to go through a lot of it together, so you're going to need your Bible. But turn to chapter 24 for just a minute. We're going to begin with that, two verses in chapter 24, verses 6 and 7. I'd like us to read. These are the words that were spoken by the angels at the empty tomb when the women came looking for Jesus. When he rose from the dead, the angels gave them a message. So it's a short passage, but if you're able, would you just stand briefly as we read this together? I'd implore us to read it out loud together today. These are the words of the angels, starting in verse 6. Let's begin. He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise. Thank you. You may be seated. The angel said, the Son of Man must be delivered. The word for delivered means what we think it means. It means to be handed over. He was handed over to sinful people, and they did whatever they wanted to do with him. But even as they were doing whatever they were wanting to do to him, they were fulfilling their sinful will in this case. He was sovereignly accomplishing God's purpose for us and for you and me so that we can be saved. There's that tension everywhere in Scripture. We looked at it in our men's Bible study yesterday of what people do and exercising their will, and yet God is sovereignly accomplishing his purposes, and we'll see that here as well. So I want to talk about Jesus being delivered, okay? The first one is this. Jesus is delivered to Pilate. We're going to go through the passage now in chapter 23, so look back at the opening verses of chapter 23. The Bible says in verse 1, then the whole company of them arose and brought him before Pilate. Now, you'll remember Jesus had been tried by the Jewish religious leaders. We saw that last week in chapter 22. And there are some many times called the Sanhedrin, that's the Jewish council. And they brought many false accusations against him at that time. And because he truthfully said he was the Son of God, when they asked him that, they charged him with blasphemy and they wanted to kill him. But the Jewish leaders didn't have the legal authority to execute anyone. So they brought him now to the Roman authorities, of which Pilate is the head of that, in order to be found guilty, in order that he might be executed by the Romans. And so that's what this is all about. Pontius Pilate was someone that hated the Jewish people, and the Jewish people really hated him. He really didn't seem to understand what was going on with Jesus, I think. History tells us that Pilate was the governor over Jerusalem, Judea, and Jerusalem for about 10 years, from AD 26 to AD 36. These are real facts in history. And the Bible says in verse 2, and they began to accuse him, saying, we found this man to be misleading our nation and forbidding us to give tribute to Caesar and saying that he himself is Christ, a king. So they came to Pilate, they made three accusations against Jesus. First of all, they said this man is misleading our nation. There was no evidence for that one, but they said he's misleading our nation. Secondly, they said he's forbidding people to give tribute to Caesar. Now, that actually was a bald-faced lie. In fact, Jesus had specifically told them, give to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God's. But they brought that false accusation. And then thirdly, they said, we found that this man is saying that he himself is Christ, a king. And that accusation was actually true. Okay? Jesus had claimed to be the Christ, the King of the Jews, and the Son of God. And so the Bible says in verse 3 that Pilate then asked him, well, are you the King of the Jews? And he answered him, you have said so. Now, if you look in the other Gospels, in this case John's Gospel, they all record this time in Jesus' life and include some different details of the events. In John chapter 18, you'll see that there's a much longer interchange, a discourse, between Pilate and Jesus. And Pilate asked him about being king of the Jews in John 18, and Jesus answered and said that his kingdom was not of this world. His kingdom was a spiritual kingdom. So Pilate understood that while Jesus claimed to be a king, a king of the Jews, that he was not a threat to Rome. He was a spiritual king, not the Roman government kind of king. And so it's recorded that Jesus answered, "You have said so." In other words, you said it, you're correct. Look at verse 4. Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no guilt in this man." Before it's all over, and we'll keep reading, you'll find that three times he says something almost identical to that. "I find no fault in this man." Something similar. In fact, the language of the original text here is very strong. It's like, "I absolutely don't find anything in which to charge Jesus with." And when the religious leaders heard that, they became even more agitated, and they said in verse 5, "He stirs up the people, teaching throughout all Judea from Galilee even to this place." Now, when Pilate heard the word Galilee, he thought, well, maybe I need to let him appear before the one who has jurisdiction over Galilee. That was a different province, Judea, Galilee. And it turned out that the leader of Galilee, the one over Galilee, was Herod, and he happened to be in town in Jerusalem at the time. I'm not reading it all, but you'll find that. And so in the verses that follow, verses 7 through 12, although we won't read them all, although Jesus was still under the jurisdiction of Pilate, he was sent to King Herod to stand before him. And in verses 7 through 12, Jesus stands before Herod, and he wouldn't answer Herod at all. He wasn't really the one that was he should be answering to. And all Herod wanted to do, by the way, was to see if Jesus might perform some miracle, some wonder, or something cool, and Jesus wouldn't do it. So after being mocked and mistreated by his soldiers, they sent Jesus back to Pilate to continue the trial. And so we keep reading in verse 13. Pilate then called together the chief priests and the rulers of the people and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was misleading the people. And after examining him before you, behold, I did not find this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither did Herod, for he sent him back to us. Look, nothing deserving death has been done by him." That's the third time. "Therefore, I will punish and release him." Now, let's stop. Make a careful note of what's going on here. Pilate found nothing wrong in Jesus. Three times he said that. Three times he said, "This man isn't worthy of a death sentence." Three times he was convinced by the evidence, but he still delivered Jesus to die ultimately. He couldn't deny the truths, but he still rejected Jesus. Think about that. Pilate stands for all of us as a sad example of what it looks like when you know the right things to do, but because of your own fear, or because of something that you don't want to do, or because of the pressure of other people, that because of whatever, you don't do what you know is the right thing to do. He knew the truth, and yet he rejected Jesus. I think that's an important life lesson, isn't it, in so many ways in our lives. It's important to know, it's important to do the right thing, the thing that we know is right, the thing we know we should do in any area of life, and not give in to any other reason and pressure to do otherwise. Right? But you know, it is a life lesson. But as important as this is as a life lesson, this is really a life and death lesson here. Because what Pilate rejected was the truth about Jesus Christ, and then he rejected Jesus Christ himself because of it. And when you reject the truth about Jesus Christ, when you reject Jesus Christ, you have rejected the one and the only one who can forgive your sins, the one and only one who can bring you to a holy God and give you a relationship with him that begins now and lasts into eternity. Even though Pilate knew it was true, he didn't take any of that. I believe there's probably some here today who you've perhaps you've seen what Jesus Christ had done in the lives of someone that you know. Maybe a family member, maybe someone else. You know very well the power of God because you've seen it. You've seen it, not that they're perfect, but you've seen a change in a person's life. You've seen them respond to things in ways you could never hope to ever respond to. You've seen the hope that they have, the transformation, the calm peace that he brings. You can't deny the evidence, but you're still rejecting Jesus today. You're still rejecting Jesus. Pilate couldn't deny the evidence. He still wound up condemning Jesus to die. He still turned away from his only hope for salvation and forgiveness and eternal life with God. You and I, if we're there, we will suffer the same consequence. If we continue to persist, we will suffer the same loss when we ignore Jesus. For whatever reason, whatever reason. And I think he's speaking to us today in this text about that. Don't you? Because we see Jesus first delivered to Pilate, and Pilate rejected the truth. Secondly, we see Jesus delivered to his enemies. And so he says, Pilate says, I will punish him and release him. And Pilate's idea was, of course, to be wishy-washy about this. You know, he didn't want to. It's kind of like a person that says, you know, Jesus is just all right with me, you know, but I'm not following him, you know. Or I believe in Jesus. I'll go and praise his name, but I'm going to live a lifestyle that I know he truly doesn't want, and I know it's not hit the path, and I'm just going to go down that path, but somehow I'm going to keep Jesus somewhere in there. I'm going to be wishy-washy about my relationship with Jesus. People do that. But it never works. You know why? Because God will keep us from sin, but sin will eventually keep us from God. If we live a lifestyle that, as we know, is sinful and is outside of the will of God, eventually, best intentions or whatever, you're gonna step away from God. Because God will keep you from sin, but sin will keep you from God. And Pilate was kind of wishy-washy here about Jesus. He says, okay, I'll beat Jesus. I'll have him flogged, and then I'll release him. And maybe if I beat him enough and the soldiers give him a real licking and give him a hard time, it'll sort of quiet down the crowds, his enemies, and it'll be okay, and I can just leave it at that. And I've done enough to placate the Jews, and all the turmoil will go away. Verse 18, but they all cried out together, away with this man, and release to us Barabbas. Here's who Barabbas was. Verse 19 tells us that. A man who had been thrown into prison for an insurrection started in the city and for murder. Barabbas was a homicidal political terrorist. He was a rebel. He was a bad man and a sinner. That's what we know about him. But they said, we want Barabbas. We want him. We want Barabbas. Release him. Crucify Jesus. Okay, there's a reason they could do that. I'm not going to get into it today. But let's keep reading. Verse 20. Pilate addressed them once more, desiring to release Jesus. He still wanted to release Jesus. But they kept shouting, crucify, crucify him. A third time he said to them, why? What evil has he done? I have found no guilt. That may be the fourth time, actually. I found no guilt, deserving death. I will therefore punish and release him. But they were urgent, demanding with a loud cries that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. He gave in. So he decided their wishes would be granted. Verse 25, it says, he released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, for whom they asked, and he delivered Jesus over to them all. So we see Jesus delivered to his enemies. And in doing that, Pilate released Barabbas, and he crucified Jesus. Who, think about it, Jesus died quite literally in place of Barabbas, right? He died in place of Barabbas. Barabbas is going to die, Jesus died. Now, before I move on to my next point, look at that name, Barabbas. Kind of interesting. It's an interesting name. Anytime you see the name in the Bible with the letters bar at the beginning, B-A-R, at the beginning of that name, the letters B-A-R mean son of, son of. So sometimes when Jesus was speaking about Simon Peter, he called him Simon Bar-Jonah. What does that mean? Peter, son of Jonah, right? In the book of Acts, there's a man named Joseph, but he was such an encourager that they actually gave him a new name. They called him Barnabas, son of encouragement. Here we meet a man named Barabbas. Bar means son. Does anyone know what Abba means? Sure you do. Some of you know your Bible. It means father. Okay, it means father. In the Aramaic language, it means father. So his name means son of the father. That's an interesting name, right? Son of the father. It's pretty generic, right? We don't know who the father's name is. He could literally be anyone to us. He could be you. He could be me. He was just the son of a father. And Jesus literally died in the place of a great sinner. And he died to pay the price for his sins. That's what Jesus did for you and me, right? So when I see the name Barabbas, it reminds me of myself because I'm condemned before God for my sin. And I deserve death and hell because of my sin. And Jesus took my place when he ascended that cross. He paid the price for my sins and yours, Barabbas. Let's move on. We see Jesus delivered to his enemies. Finally, we see Jesus delivered to the cross. Look at verse 26 and 27. And as they led him away, they seized one Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, and laid on him the cross to carry it behind Jesus. And there, following him, a great multitude of the people and of women who were mourning and lamenting for him. By the way, in my study this week, I ran across something. It's not the main point here, but something I never actually considered before, that there's not even one place that I could find or anyone talk about in the Bible where a woman ever spoke negatively about Jesus. And here, as Jesus was making his way to the cross, multitudes of people, and specifically women, were mourning and lamenting for him. Look at verse 28. But turning to them, Jesus said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children." He says, don't cry for me, cry for yourselves. Weep for your children, because Jesus knew that in just a few years, Jerusalem was going to be surrounded by enemies. It turns out the Romans, who they were trying to get to kill Jesus, and it would be destroyed. It would be torn to pieces. And so because of the judgment that they faced for rejecting Jesus, the Messiah, Jesus said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, weep for yourselves. Wail for your children." Verse 32, two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Three crosses, Jesus in the center. One thing we see when you consider Barabbas, who Jesus took his place, right? And the two criminals crucified on either side of him. Jesus Christ at this moment was surrounded by sinners, wasn't he? So appropriate when you know why he was there. He was making a way. He was making a way for all of us who are sinners. He was making the way, the only way for sinners to be delivered. Here we see Jesus delivered to the cross. They made their way to a place that says called the skull. Now the Bible says in verse 26, they forced a man by the name of Simon of Cyrene to carry the cross for Jesus. Now Roman executioners almost always forced the criminal to carry their cross to the place of crucifixion. But the reality is Jesus had been beaten so severely and so much that he was physically unable to carry his cross anymore. And he was falling and he couldn't do it. So they pressed an outsider, Simon of Cyrene, into service. It says he came from Cyrene, which is an area in Africa. He was there perhaps visiting Jerusalem for the Passover. But he was an outsider. No one knew who he was, basically. But notice something. Luke knew his name. Why? Why would he know this man's name? He was a stranger to everyone. Here's what most scholars believe, and I think it makes sense. The reason Luke, and by the way, Matthew and Mark also mention his name at this point in the text, the reason they knew his name and they record it here is because Simon of Cyrene wound up becoming a follower of Jesus Christ and was a part of that early church that followed Jesus. And so when Luke said his name here, the early readers of his gospel back then, they actually knew Simon of Cyrene. Oh yeah, he's the one. We know him. So if that's the case, this was not the last time Simon would pick up his cross and follow Jesus, was it? Because he, like us, answered the call that Jesus gave to his life and to all followers then and now, as it's recorded in Luke 9:23 and elsewhere, to take up our crosses daily and follow him. Are you doing that? Am I doing that? He carried the cross for Jesus as he came to the place called the skull. Verse 33. You might want to, if you have your own Bible, you might want to underline the word the skull, and I'll give you some information about that. In the Greek language, it's the word cranius, and it's where we get our word cranium, skull, okay, from. In the Aramaic language, it's the word Golgotha. We use that word sometimes to talk about the place where Jesus was crucified, Golgotha. In the Latin language, the word is translated Calvaria or Calvary. That's why we also call the place Calvary. It's the same place, the skull, Golgotha, Calvary, Greek, Aramaic, and Latin. It's interesting. It's one of the places that we don't know the exact location of. If you ever get to go to the Holy Land or you study about the Holy Land, when you go on a tour, which we had the good fortune to do, at this point they go, we don't know where it is. We think it could be this location. It might be that location, but it's really unknown where the spot was that Jesus died on the cross and where he was buried. It may have been a dome-shaped rock that resembled a skull. It may have been a place where there were skulls of those who had been executed and crucified over the years. But in any case, it was a gruesome place. The skull. They call it the skull. You know, many other places are known, just so I think you know that. Last week, we saw pictures of the Garden of Gethsemane. We know where that is. We know where the Palace of the Sanhedrin was. We were there. Jacob's Well, where Jesus drew from in John chapter 4. We know where the temple is, and many others. You know, we know big places like the temple, little places like a tiny little well out in the middle of nowhere. You can go to those things if you're there. You can see them online. You can read about them. They're there. And you know, the reason I remind you of that is because we know those things. it's a powerful reminder that the gospel story is not a fiction. It's nonfiction. It's real. These are real places, real detailed facts, not just the big things like a temple, but little things. This is the greatest story ever told, and it's a real story. Amen? And that helps us to know that. But this location, Calvary, is not one of those places. The tomb and the place where the cross was erected are not known for certain. I think that was, God did that on purpose. Because for one reason, if we knew the exact place, we humans would begin to revere and worship the place rather than the work of Christ that happened at that place. Because, boy, we're very religious. In fact, some do that already, even for the places they're not sure of. Here's another thought, and we're going to close with this one because we're going to continue this wonderful story on another Sunday. Some people ask me, and I'm sure others have been asked who have gotten a chance to go, when you went to Israel, Pastor, did you ever visit Calvary? And my answer, of course, you know the answer now, is no. But I'll say no, but I visited Calvary many, many, many years before I ever went on a trip to Israel. I visited Calvary personally for the first time, and the most important time, when I was about 20 years old, as a young college student, because it was then that I truly heard in my heart the good news that Jesus Christ went to the cross and died there, and what he did for me. And it was at that point that I turned in faith and I trusted Christ. And I put my trust in him and I asked him to save me, and he did. And my life has been different because of that. It was at that point I went to Calvary. You know, at that moment, God took me to Calvary, and where my sins had been paid for by my Savior. And Jesus saved me and restored me and delivered me. You can't get saved without taking a trip to Calvary. Just think with me for a moment about what Calvary means for you. Calvary was a place of ransom where Jesus made payment for your debt and mine. Calvary was a place of substitution where Jesus took the punishment that you deserve. You're the Barabbas. Calvary was a place of propitiation where Jesus' perfect sacrifice wiped away God's anger and wrath and judgment meant for us. He took it. Calvary was a place of closure where Jesus put an end to that old life that you were living, and it was a place of beginnings where the final breath of Jesus breathed new life into us. Calvary was a place of mediation where Jesus stood between your sin and God's holiness. Calvary was a place of reconciliation where Jesus brokered peace between you and Almighty God. Calvary was a place of justification, where Jesus made you right and righteous in the eyes of a holy God. And Calvary was a place of victory, where Jesus threw down sin and defeated Satan forever and ever. Calvary was a place of deliverance, where you and I were redeemed, set free, set on a new path that will last for eternity. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank God for Calvary. We're going to pick up the story of Jesus and the cross and what happened. It's a wonderful story, and it should thrill us deep down the next time we come to Luke. Next week, by the way, the youth are going to be having Youth Sunday, and they're going to be sharing, and then we'll pick up after that. But we're going to keep going in this wonderful story of Jesus, this true story. So I want to close with this. I just want to ask you, have you been to Calvary? Have you been to Calvary? Because when Jesus was delivered to the cross, there Jesus delivered you. Have you been to Calvary? The Bible says this in Colossians. It says it all over the place, but here's one from Colossians, verse 13. It says, He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom. There's a slide for this. To the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. When Jesus was delivered to that cross, He delivered you from darkness and brought you to God's light. He delivered you from sin and brought you to God's salvation. His name is Jesus. Jesus. And He came to die on that cross for you and me. He was delivered all the way to Calvary's cross. How do you receive that deliverance? Well, many places tell us, but I think John 1 tells us as clearly as anywhere. It says He came to His own. That was the Jews. We're reading the story now, putting in the details. He came into His own, and His own people did not receive Him. But to all who did receive Him, who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God. Born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. That's how. When we come to the cross, we come to Jesus on the cross at Calvary, we recognize what He did for us, and we put our trust and hope and faith in that. I did that. Many of you have done that. But if you've never done that, we do it today. You'll never be the same if you will. I'm going to put up a prayer and we're going to close. It's a prayer. It's a simple prayer. Put it up in the past. But it doesn't mean anything if it stays on the screen or on a piece of paper. It only means something if it comes from your heart to God. But this is what we've been talking about from Scripture. To say, Jesus, I believe You are God's Son. And I trust You alone as my Lord and my Savior. I turn from my sin and I receive Your gift of forgiveness. Can you say that to Him? I hope you can. There's nothing holding you back except yourself. Don't be like Pilate. Know the truth and walk away. Because there's no hope after that. May God bless you as we close today, and may God bless all of us as we follow Him and go to the cross day by day and put our faith in Him. We're going to sing a song as we close. Jose is going to come and lead us and ask you to stand. If you're here today and you have a public response to make, and there's many wonderful responses. A couple I'll just mention. I mention them often. If you're here and you've confessed your faith in Jesus Christ to Him, come and share it with me and we'll share it with the congregation. Jesus never called anyone privately. He's always called them to come out and be part of the faith community. Come and do that. It's a crazy easy place to do that because we love Jesus and we'll love you when you come and do that. And just come and stand with me and share that. If it's to be baptized, which is the next step in your salvation experience, come and do that. If it's to join as a member, I'd love to have you do that as well. So come and stand with me in the front or the deacons who are going to come and stand on the sides here as we close.
Alas. Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would He devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? Was it for crimes that I had done?
before we close, I just want to share with you that Jackie and Adolfo, who got married a couple weeks ago, that was exciting, have come forward to be baptized as followers of Jesus and to become, through that, members of the church. And we're so thankful. And they have joined me in the on-ramp class and gone through all of that and understand and have a personal faith commitment to Jesus, and they want to follow him today. And church, if you'd like to receive them on their day of baptism as members, would you say amen?
Amen.
I thought so. We're so thrilled to have you part of our church. I know God has plans to use you. You have gifts and talents that you're going to discover, that you're going to be able to minister to other people in the church, and they have the gifts that God gave them to help you to grow as a Christian. So very excited for that. May God bless you. And welcome them in today, and let them know how much you care. We'll set up a time for baptism soon, okay? God bless you. You could be dismissed. And if you're here this morning and there's a decision that you maybe needed to make and didn't make, you want to come up and see me. I'll stand up here for a little while, and then I'm going to head and have a cookie. So get your cookies before I do. In other words, there's refreshments out there. Take a minute and enjoy them before you go. May God bless you. We are dismissed.